Hey everyone, it's Sandy Adams, and you're listening to a Seven Girls of You podcast.
Hey everyone, welcome to another edition of my podcast. Today's special guest is Dr. Marie Teresa Hernandez. She's a professor of world cultures and literature here at the University of Houston. And I'm so excited to have her with us today on this podcast. But before we get started, I just want to give you a little bit of background. So she will be actually talking about the Conversos, A Secret Past, here in Houston next Thursday, October 11th, as part of a lecture series that the group that I'm associated with, Archaeology Now, has put on for the season. This specific talk will be dealing with secret identity. Our theme this year is identity overall, but her lecture will be dealing with secret identity. And we're not going to get into a lot about the Conversos today because we're going to save that for her lecture. However, I do think it's important that you understand a tad bit of what Conversos are. So the Conversos are Jews who were forced to convert to Christianity in Spain and Portugal beginning in the 14th century. And it's a subject that I did not know anything about until we put together this program for this season. And how it affects or it connects with Mexico and Texas, which it does directly connect with them, is that a group of these Converso Jews actually immigrated to Mexico and Texas. And now there are families along the southern Texas border and into New Mexico that, because of genealogy and the DNA testing, are now discovering their Jewish ancestry. So it's a fascinating topic, and I'm very excited to hear more about that next Thursday. But anyway, enough of that. Thank you, Dr. Hernandez, for joining me today. I'm very excited, so welcome.
Welcome to you, too. It's great to talk to you, Sandy.
Okay, so the first thing that I really want to know, as just a normal person out there, is how did you get into not only world cultures, but how did you, when you were little, did you have this sudden desire to teach or to do research, or how did you grow up into what you are now?
I had a father that never stopped telling me stories, and he would tell me stories about everything, about Mexico, about Texas, about the Alamo, about the presidents of Mexico, about the sheriffs of Fort Bend County, all sorts of things, always telling me stories, describing things, telling me about people. And then when I was six, he bought me an encyclopedia, and I was an only child, so I read most of it by third grade.
That's interesting, because I did the same thing as a child. I had older brothers and sisters, but I read the encyclopedia all the time. I knew more about Egyptian history than anybody else in my class, and I loved the encyclopedias. Too bad they don't have them. Everything's online today. So how did that progress from when you were little reading encyclopedias until getting into teaching?
I actually didn't think of being a professor or being in the academy until my children were already in high school and college. I went through college rather quickly and got an MSW when I was 21. Then I worked.
What is an MSW?
Master's in Social Work.
Okay.
And I worked for a number of years as a psychotherapist and got a lot of training as a psychotherapist and was quite well prepared. I had a private practice.
Wow.
And I would say about when I was turned 40, maybe it was a midlife crisis, I discovered photography, which is a story I haven't told you about yet. And I studied for a number of years and actually had a number of shows, and I just fell in love with it. It changed my life. I had this really, really good teacher, and I just started seeing the world totally in a different way. So I said, I've got to do something with this. And so somehow or another, I was able to get, well, accepted by two different doctoral programs. And in my mind, I was going to, with PhD in anthropology, I was going to analyze images. And one of the first things I thought about was maybe analyzing the collection of images from the Mexican Revolution that are at the Museum of Fine Arts.
Right.
And so I was accepted at the University of Texas and at Rice. And at Rice, they were really excited because of my photography background. And also my mental health background, because that does give you a way of maybe understanding things. And I had a extra training and understanding groups. So that's what I was thinking I was going to do. And it started with using the photography in everything I did. So my first book is full of pictures. And then it just slowly started going into other things. The program was very interdisciplinary. It was anthropology, but we studied literature and history and social theory, religion, popular culture, everything. Basically, we studied stories and narratives. And so that's what I started looking at, that and how history gets written and put together. And so that's how I ended up getting the PhD, is looking at stories that couldn't be documented, mostly about conversos, but also I was looking at folklore and issues of spirits and just things you can't see. I was always really fascinated with things we couldn't see, but we knew were there. So that's kind of how it all started. As far as world cultures, I just sort of fell into it because at the time I was getting my PhD, which was in the late 90s, there wasn't a lot of talk about what we call now cultural studies, which is what I'm doing, basically. Wow. Cultural studies. That's what they call it now. And I just fell into it. I got a job in the humanities at the University of Houston, and there was this really small program they called World Cultures with no professors. They had a couple of classes, and I built up the program starting 7 years ago, and I started adding classes, putting things together. And now we have this program where we basically look at is empires and how the development of empires and their colonies has affected the world and how it affects us now. And we look at different things to understand that, like novels, right, fiction, films, and of course, academic texts too.
So you talked about, how did you learn about the conversos? Was that something that your dad had talked about when you were growing up, or did you learn that once you got into school and started studying at the university level?
I had no idea. You know, I might have heard something, but not from my family. And my dad's best friend was a Basilian priest. Those are the priests that were affiliated with Dominique de Mille.
Right.
He was very, very literate, and he was at our house every single day. So that was another big influence. So it was actually, and I went to Catholic school, so it was actually a very Catholic type of upbringing, very conservative. What happened, I think I must have been in my early 30s, I went to a genealogy conference in San Antonio with some friends, and there was a historian there giving a talk about the Jews of Monterey. And all of us had never heard anything about it, and we were just fascinated. But even at that, you know, I was very curious, but I never really looked into it until I did my field work in Monterey. I went back there in my first trip, I think I made it in 1997, and ended up working very closely with a newspaper reporter who had been actually a news television anchor, and had already retired, and he had the show every week where he would drive around little towns in northern Mexico. And so we would, every Tuesday, we'd get in a van with a cameraman and this guy, he's like in his 70s, and we would drive up into the mountains all over the place. It was an amazing experience. And he, you know, while we're sitting there talking, he starts telling me about this, that they call them Sefarditas, which would be the Sephardic Jews. And the Sefarditas were who settled northern Mexico. And he had written a book that had a couple of chapters, and he was always telling me about it. And so that sort of made really piqued my curiosity. And then I started asking other people, and they would tell me little things that they knew. And then I started reading about it. And there were a few things that were written already at that time. And so the first book is more about the stories. It was nothing concrete. It's just more.
And that's the book that you've written, correct?
Yes, that's a Delirio, which means delirium, Delirio. The fantastic, the demonic, and the real, the buried history of Nuevo León. So, and when I say buried, I'd say because it was a history that people are very ambivalent about it. They'll, at the museums, they used to say, oh no, there were never any Jews here, but then the people would always be talking about it. After that, I wasn't sure what I was going to do for my next project, but I kept reading about it because you know, as the years went on, more and more came up and I found other things. But what really did it was in 2007, I ran into hundreds of pages of handwritten documents at the New York Public Library, written by a priest in 1825 in Mexico, who was a secret Jew. And I'm talking about pages and pages and pages of all these discussions he's having about Jewish history, about the Old Testament, lots of stuff that regular Christians don't even know about. Right. So I said, wow, maybe I need to write about this some more. And that's kind of what set that off. But I couldn't quite figure out where to put this story of this guy in all these hundreds of pages. So what I did was, just to satisfy my own curiosity, I wanted to understand why in 1825 there were still secret Jews in Mexico, long after the Inquisition was over. And that's what that book ended up being.
So for those, my audience out there, because I'm sure many of them do not have a background in history. So can you just briefly tell us what conversos are?
Well, in 1492, Ferdinand and Isabel decided, for a number of different reasons, they wanted all the Jews out of their country and all of the Muslims. And as far as the Jews were concerned, if they converted to Christianity, they did not have to leave. However, you know that if you are very solidly, you know, filled with one type of identity, it's very difficult to change from one day to the next. Right. So many of the people that stayed were Christians on the outside and Jews on the inside.
And that's where we get the word conversos. It means they were converted, whether they
were converted. Yeah, there was another term too that I didn't know until I wrote the last book that was used very commonly, but way back then, you know, in the 1500s, 1600s, was a word called tornadizo. Torna, like T-O-R-N-A-D-I-Z-O. Torna in Spanish, it means the person that turns right back and forth. And so conversos were also called tornadizos because they would go back and forth with the religion, or some of them would. There's another term that's very, I believe, very derogatory. It's a Marrano, which means pig. And I think that's, I just don't think it's a good idea. It's not ethical, I think, to use it. But a number of scholars do, even today. They use it when they're writing. The crypto Jews is another term also. And some people that are descended from Jews actually, and that have at least on the outside been Christians for a long time, actually call themselves Jews, but from what I understand, the Jewish rabbis often don't like that, you know, because they say that people who left the religion many years ago cannot consider themselves Jews now. So that's sort of a point of contention.
Actually. Right, and I understand from the press release that I'm reading right here, that you are possibly a descendant of an early Texan who possibly is descended from conversos. Is that correct?
Well, there's no like absolute truth, but in my genealogy, you know, which I've worked on for a number of years and have taken back to the 1600s, yes, I'm, according to my genealogy, I'm descended from a number of different families that were the first families that came to northern Mexico, and then ultimately moved to South Texas. And those families, yes, they were, most of them, if not all, were conversos or descendants of conversos. But I don't have proof where someone said, yes, our family was. It just, the genealogy shows it.
Right.
And so, my daughter's 34% Portuguese.
Oh, interesting.
The story is, if you're Portuguese, in the old days, they say if you're Portuguese, you're definitely a secret Jew.
Oh, and why is that?
Because after 1492, many, many, many Jews migrated to Portugal.
Oh, okay. So I know that we cannot touch on very much of the lecture coming up because we don't want to spoil that for everybody else. But you had told me that we could talk about the monks. So what is the story about the monks?
Well, when I was working on the last book, The Virgin of Guadalupe and the Conversos, as I wanted to go back in time to see if there was some way I could show how the narratives had continued on and on all the way to 1825. I decided to focus on the Virgin of Guadalupe, which of course she's very popular here and throughout the Americas. At the time, I didn't really know that there was the first Virgin of Guadalupe in Spain in a town named Guadalupe. And she looked very different from the one that we know now. She's jet black, her skin is jet black. And she's made of cedar and she's only 3 feet tall. And she's painted where it'd be like golden red and blue, and was constructed probably somewhere around 1100 AD. Mm-hmm. And somehow or another, they said she was lost and they found her, which is often what you hear about these holy saints or, you know, religious people. And they found her, and then they created a sanctuary for her that grew into a very large monastery that by about 1500, it was the richest monastery in all of Europe.
And that's called, where is that at then?
Guadalupe, Spain, which is about a 3-hour bus ride southwest of Madrid, up in the mountains, very high up in the mountains. And the monastery was established by 1200, but it grew larger and larger. And some of the original sections of the monastery go all the way back to that time. And so it was known and it was documented. I found it in, you know, book after book. And these were things that were published many, many, many centuries ago, that these monks, they were called the Hieronymites, or in Spanish, the Jerónimos. And they were called the monks of the king. And they were also called the monks of the nobility. And they were also known as being an order of monks that was mostly conversos or descendants of conversos.
Right.
And this was all very clear, open information, talked about all the time. It was no secret. And it was tolerated by Isabel and Ferdinand, and really no problem until they were getting close to the time of 1492. And I believe it was around 1470, maybe a little bit after, they ordered the Inquisition to go to the monastery. And they found a number of monks that were practicing Jewish rites in the monastery. And some that were even like acting as priests and doing liturgy that had never even been baptized as Christians.
Wow.
And there was, excuse me?
I said, wow.
Yeah, there were a number of monasteries of the Hieronymites throughout Spain, but this was the largest and the richest, and it was favored by King Philip II. So in the 1500s, it was very powerful. It was so wealthy. The monks themselves were so wealthy, they would lend money to the monarchy so they could have wars or, you know, conduct their wars. They also took in people, other people that were maybe hiding from the Inquisition. And like I said, many of them were noblemen and many of them were highly educated, but had gone to live in the monastery. And they had a medical school and hospitals. They were one of the first that performed autopsies. So it was a very interesting world that they had at that time.
So is that order, is there still remnants of that order in today's world anywhere?
Very, very few. I think just a handful in one of the remaining monasteries. In 1808, when Napoleon entered Spain and destroyed many of the churches and the monasteries in different places, the convents, the order was basically destroyed. And another terrible, terrible thing that happened was that, especially Guadalupe, but at the other places also, they had these amazing libraries, amazing, thousands and thousands of books, and those disappeared, basically.
Is that monastery, or the remnants of that monastery actually still in existence?
Yes. Monastery is still there. I spent 3 weeks at the monastery. You can actually stay in it. So I spent like a week inside the monastery, staying in a room, and then 2 other weeks in the village. So, and I spent time in the archives and got to know a former archivist. And yes, it was part of the research.
So who controls that monastery now? The government?
The Franciscans.
Oh, okay. The Franciscans.
Mm-hmm. But a number of the archives are still there, but they lost almost everything.
Wow. Well, thank you so much. We're getting close to our time, and I appreciate all the information. It's a fascinating subject. And like I had told you previously when we were talking yesterday, I grew up in a small town in Tennessee, and we didn't have any Jewish people in our town. We only had one Catholic person that moved in, I think, when I was later in elementary school. So it was something I had not really heard of until just recently. And it's just a fascinating thing. And I'm very excited to hear the lecture on October 11th. And especially how the connection with the DNA and how that's really, you know, brought to light this hidden identity that we talk about and just changing a lot of people's lives, really whether they want to have them changed or not. You know, finding out your identity is one thing. When you thought it was something else can be scary and can be eye-opening. And I remember when I had seen a genealogy chart when I was 18, and my aunt wanted me to help her with something, and I saw a name on there, and it was obvious that I thought the name was probably Scottish, and I always wanted to be Scottish. And then I go and do the research and find out that we are indeed have a Scottish line. So it's sometimes it kind of answers questions that you've had about yourself that you really didn't know. And then sometimes it opens up, you know, a whole nother can of worms. So do you have a project that you're going to start on or that you're currently working on? What's in your future?
Well, right now, for the last year, I've been working on a project about a man named Juan Nepomuceno Cortina, who lived on the border, was born in 1824 and lived most of the 18th century, who also probably I would say 90% sure he was also descended from Conversos, because his family, he's got a lot of the same family surnames of the ones that state that they are. He was a part of the wealthiest family, one of the largest landowning families in South Texas. They owned over 260,000 acres before the Mexican-American War. And he rebelled against losing their land and ended up being almost kind of like made his own army and went out throughout South Texas and controlled much of South Texas in 1859, 1860, and worked with the Union also during the Civil War. He was really quite a character, very, very intelligent, pretty wild. And he was written about in newspapers all over the United States. I found over 200 articles about him. He's quite a fascinating guy.
So you have currently two books that are for sale or just one?
I'm going to only be selling two at the conference because I have three books. But only two are concerning the topic, and they will be at the conference for sale.
Are all of your books for sale online? Because I would like to link that in the post when we actually publish your podcast.
Yes, they are all online. The third book is Cemeteries of Ambivalent Desire, and it's about slavery and post-Reconstruction in Southeast Texas, primarily Fort Bend County.
Okay, well then I will make sure to get all that information from you and I will put it in the post when the podcast goes up. And thank you so much for spending the evening with me. We appreciate it. And I look forward to hearing your lecture on the 11th, which is a week from today. No, yes. 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 A week from tomorrow. Thank you very much, Terry, and we appreciate that. Everybody out there, thank you so much for listening today. We hope that you learned a lot, or have if you have additional questions, I'll put the information in the post when the podcast is published. But anyway, thank you so much, Terry, and you have a great evening.
You too. Bye-bye.
Thank you so much for joining us today. We hope that this has been a fascinating subject. And if you would like to learn more about the Conversos, Dr. Hernandez's book, The Virgin of Guadalupe and the Conversos, Uncovering Hidden Influences from Spain to Mexico, is available for purchase on Amazon.com. You can search for that by title or also by her name. I will include that in the post when this podcast goes live. To learn more about Archaeology Now, you can go to our website, archaeologynow.org. We promote awareness and appreciation of world cultures through archaeology. 51 years ago, the organization was founded by Dominique Day DeMille and Philip Oliver Smith and Walter Widrig. That's the one here in Houston. Today, through our programming, we seek to find common links to those who have come before us, to acknowledge the basic dignity of all humankind, and ultimately to advance mutual understanding among Houston's diverse community. Archaeology Now is a subgroup of the Archaeological Institute of America, headquartered in Boston, Massachusetts. Thank you so much for joining us today. We much appreciate it.